Today, we're going to discuss a much anticipated topic, how to train Wan to point to Lora. The videos you are currently watching are examples of video effects generated using the Wan to point to Lora that I trained. Let's observe the quality of the images, the richness of the colors, the consistency of character movements, and the overall visual feel. All are exceptionally good. Regarding the training of Wan 2.2 Lora, it's crucial to understand that there are primarily two types of Lora configurations available. The first type involves separate Lora models. As we know, Wan 2.2 consists of two main models, a high noise model and a low noise model. During training, we have the option to train them independently. This means we can train a Lora specifically for the high noise model, and then train another Lora specifically for the low noise model. Alternatively, we can opt for joint training, where a single Lora can be applied to both the high noise and low noise models. The performance characteristics of Lora models trained using these two distinct approaches will vary slightly, which we will elaborate on in more detail later. Let's begin by examining the selection of training tools. I've made a slight change to the tool I'm using. Previously, I relied on AI Toolkit. The advantage of AI Toolkit is its simplicity. It features a UI interface that allows users to easily complete training tasks with mouse clicks. However, it also has drawbacks, such as difficulty in model downloading and higher resource consumption. So, what are the disadvantages of Musubi Tuner? Its main drawback is the absence of a built-in UI interface. While third-party UIs have been developed, the official team doesn't explicitly recommend any particular one for use. However, Musubi Tuner's significant advantage lies in its lower resource utilization. We can review its hardware requirements here. Generally, 12GB of RAM is sufficient for image training, and 24GB of RAM is adequate for video training. Furthermore, Musubi Tuner incorporates several techniques to reduce RAM usage, such as the well-known block swap, which involves exchanging blocks with memory, thereby further minimizing resource consumption and offering more flexible configurations. Today's video will cover the entire process of Wan 2.2 Lora training. First, let's look at the environment, which is Musubi Tuner. I recommend using a graphics card with approximately 24GB of VRAM. In the latter half of this video, I will show you how to build the training environment from the ground up. Let's briefly discuss the directory structure. Please note that within its workspace directory, I have a folder named Musubi Tuner. This contains the code from the repository we just examined. It's important to know that the dataset directory and output directory were newly created by me. In the models directory, I have already downloaded all the Wan 2.2 models for your convenience. To begin training, the first step is to download the models. Pay close attention to the model download links, as they can be somewhat complicated. Why? Because for the Wan 2.2-1.4b model, we are focusing on the 1.4b model. Not the 5.5b1, the primary model used is 2.2, but the T5 encoder and VAE are from 2.1. Therefore, you will notice that we download the main model from here. Let's open it. Upon reviewing this, you might realize that we are not directly downloading the original repository content from Hugging Face. Specifically, the models found within ComfyOS Diffusion model. Therefore, you simply need to download the Wan 2.2 T2V 1.4b high noise model and low noise model from this location. It is crucial to download the FP1.6 version, not the FP8 version. You might ask why. Please note that the documentation contains a table that outlines the support status for Lora and main models during Wan 2.2 or Wan 2.1 model training. This table specifies the precision of your trained model and the precision of the output Lora. If you choose BF16, you can output BF16 Lora, FP8, or FP8 scale. All these options are available. If you use FP16, you can only output FP16, FP8, and FP8 scale. However, if you select an FP8 scale model, you won't be able to train anything. Let's revisit the model list content. If we select that option, you won't be able to train anything. Since it doesn't provide the FP8 E3M4 format, we are left with this option. Right? The T5 encoder must be downloaded from its original repository, as it differs from the one provided by ComfyWise official source. The VAE can be downloaded from either 2.1 or 2.2, but ensure the version you use is from 2.1. This covers the model download process. Next, let's look at the dataset. I've directly moved into the pre-processing stage here. There is a process for dataset construction. Currently, we offer three methods, and my current dataset is built using a combination of these three approaches. The first method uses the face swapping workflow I provided. which is capable of generating high-precision, character-consistent images. If you need clarification, you can refer to that specific video. The second method involves using Quen Image Edit, which can also create high-quality training datasets. Detailed explanations for this content can be found in that particular video. The third method utilizes Nano Banana to generate character-consistent images. You might wonder which method I used to construct this dataset. Please note, my datasets were compiled using all three methods collectively. I then selected approximately 20 of the better images to serve as our training dataset. I believe the quality of this dataset is quite high. My trigger word is Sendi, which is an English name I've assigned. Regarding dataset construction, keep these fundamental principles in mind. 1. Aim to include various perspectives. For instance, our dataset includes side profiles, full body shots, and a diverse range of poses. 2. Close-up shots should constitute a sufficient proportion. What do I mean by close-ups? Like these. Avoid having too many distant shots, as this will compromise the consistency of your trained model. 3. Prompt writing style. You should endeavor to omit descriptions of consistent elements. Do not write about them. Instead, focus on extensively describing the elements that vary. What does this imply? Let's take hairstyles as an example. If every character in your dataset has the same hairstyle, then I want the Lora I trained to replicate that specific hairstyle without significant alterations. Consequently, my prompts will not include any description of hairstyles. However, if your images feature diverse elements, such as high ponytails, bangs, no bangs, red hair, or yellow hair, then you must explicitly articulate these differences in your prompts. Furthermore, try to make your prompts as detailed as possible. The more detailed your prompts, the more parameters will be involved during training, leading to a higher degree of diversity in the generated output. After the dataset is built, you need to create a new folder within your workspace. Mine is named Dataset, and inside it, there's a folder called Sendi 1.2.2. This folder contains the images and their corresponding caption files. Following this, we proceed to the data pre-processing stage. This means that prior to training, to enhance speed, we must encode the data. What does encoding entail? It's quite straightforward. Notice that I have a folder named Sendi 1 to point to cache. Inside, you will find two files, one for the encoded images and another for the encoded prompts. As we all know, whether it's images or prompts, they must be encoded before training. Training images are encoded using V, while our prompts are encoded using a text encoder. Therefore, we should aim to encode them first and then save them. Let's examine image encoding. We utilize one cache latent to encode images into the latent space. Here, I will configure the dataset config. This is a critically important file known as the data configuration file. This data configuration file adheres to the TOML format. You need to prepare this file in advance. I've placed it under the dataset folder, named Sendi 1.2.2.2.ml. Let's open it and take a look. It's very simple, following a fixed format. Within this file, we need to specify two main sections. 1. General configuration. This section requires you to define the resolution. Mine is currently 1024x1024. Additionally, specify the file extension for your caption files. Mine is .txt. What is the batch size? Mine is 1. And whether bucketing should be performed, I've set this to true. Lastly, whether upscaling is needed here, we set it to false. 2. Dataset configuration. The first part specifies the location of our training images and caption files. The second part defines our cache directory, which is where the V-encoded training images and text-encoded prompts will be stored after encoding. Furthermore, it asks if you need to generate additional datasets repeatedly, which is typically used for expanding training data. This constitutes the basic structure. During training, you can directly copy this format and fill in your details. Now, back to the commands. To encode images, we naturally need V, so we specify the VAE's location. Once this command is executed, you will find all these files in the cache folder. Prompt encoding is similar to image encoding, except here the command is changed to one cache text encoder output.py. The configuration file remains the same. Here, you need to specify the T5 encoder. The batch size here is set a bit small. 16 is too large. I recommend setting it to 4. Following this, we move on to the model training phase. Let's open the terminal. First, I'll navigate into the Musubi Tuner folder. Then, you need to decide whether you want to train separate Lora models for the high noise and low noise models, or train a single, unified Lora model. Some might argue that joint training yields better results. However, this can sometimes be challenging. For example, if you only have 16 GB of VRAM, in such a scenario, attempting to train high noise and low noise models simultaneously might not be feasible. Let's first discuss separate training. Observe this content. First, we look at the task. Task refers to the specific training task you intend to execute. This is a standard syntax that you can look up. We are performing 1.2.2.1.4.BT2V training, so it must be written in this specific manner. Currently, I am training the low noise model separately, so we will focus on the DIT model. Note that I've provided the path to the low noise model. Below that is my dataset configuration, which is the TOML file we discussed earlier. Here, we specify our attention type. If you have Sage Attention installed, you can use it, but for a safer approach, you can use SPDA. Further down, we define our precision. Note that this relates to the main model, which is FP16. This is acceptable, so we write it this way. The Lora we train should be FP8 base. Next, we specify our optimizer. If you've manually written neural networks, you should be familiar with the need for an optimizer and a learning rate. I'm using the official settings for these. Then, we set the module we are using. It must be written as networks. Lora. Our DIM value, also known as rank, is 32. How many epochs do we train for? It's important to distinguish that this refers to epochs, not steps. I'm setting it to 300 epochs. Of course, you can set it lower. I suggest a minimum of 200 and a maximum of 300. Epochs and steps are distinct. Since I have 12 images, 300 epochs would convert to approximately 6,000 steps. Furthermore, regarding how we save the model, I save it every 10 epochs. This frequency is actually a bit high. You could set it to 25 or 50. Then, you specify where to save the model. I'm saving it under the Output 1 folder. And what is the name of the saved model? It is extremely important to enable block swap. There are a total of 40 blocks. We aim to utilize as many as possible. Since we've enabled it, we swap out 35 blocks. Additionally, when training a separate model, you must include these two specific settings. This relates to a core principle of Wan 2.2. Because high noise and low noise models are considered mixture of experts, MO models, they have an inherent switching mechanism. The switching point is determined by the signal-to-noise ratio. If the logarithm is 0.875, a switch can occur. Since you are performing separate model training, this automatic switching cannot happen. Therefore, we must simulate this process. How do we simulate it? For the low noise model, we set min time step to 0 and max time step to 875. This is specific to the low noise model. For the high noise model, these values must change to 875 for min time step and 1000 for max time step. So, for separate training, these two parameters are absolutely essential. Moreover, the latter part must maintain its overall distributed shape. These two are mandatory additions. What are the differences when training simultaneously? First, note that for the DIT settings, there will be two DIT parameters, DIT high noise and DIT. DIT specifies the location of the low noise model, while DIT high noise specifies the location of the high noise model. Also, notice the shift value, which we might not have mentioned earlier, is 8.0. Another important point is that these two parameters are not required during simultaneous training, because it will automatically perform a switch at the 0.875 position by default. Alright, now let's initiate a training session. I will directly train both the high noise and low noise models together. Then, I'll enter the command line. Please remember that my current directory must be Musubi Tuner. All our datasets are already prepared. Now I'll paste the command and press enter. What follows is a long waiting process. First, the low noise model loads. The high noise model has now finished loading. It now needs to be converted to the FP8 mode. Next, we begin loading the low denoising model. Its structure is identical to the high noise model, so we will need to wait a bit longer. Below, we can observe that block swap is now active. There are a total of 40 blocks, and we have swapped out 35 blocks. Now, training commences. Note that we need to train for a total of 5,700 steps. The first epoch is currently underway. After every 10 epochs, you will find a model file in the output directory. The progress bar has appeared. there are two critical points we need to clarify here. One, first, you should understand that you are training one model, one Lora, which is designed to be compatible with both high noise and low noise. It does not simultaneously output two separate models. This distinction is important. Second, regarding training time, training for 200 epochs typically takes around 6 hours. Once training is complete, please note that we need to convert the model. Although some claim that the trained model is directly compatible with ComfyY, this is not always guaranteed. Therefore, we generally proceed with a conversion step. For this, we will use convert-lora.py. We specify which model you want to convert, typically the final one. Define the target save location and provide a name. Then, set a fixed target as other. Do not overlook this step. After the training is finished, we can move into the testing phase. For testing, you can select a standard 1.2 text-to-video workflow. This is a dedicated testing workflow. Notice that here, we have separately loaded the high noise model and the low noise model. We also loaded an acceleration LoRa, which is Light X2V. And this is the model I trained. Take a look at the converted model. As you can see, it's a single mode. For the prompt, I took a shortcut. I used an image and processed it through running Hub Captioner. Of course, when you use it, you don't necessarily have to rely on an image to prompt conversion. You can write your own prompts. I just did this for convenience. I'll upload a random image now to generate a video. I'll select this one. It's quite beautiful, isn't it? Then, I'll fix the seed to 42, which is commonly used. I'll set the latter part to 0. This will make it easier to observe the effect when I compare it with the separately trained Lora later. Let's execute it. Take a look at the result. The effect is still very good. Because the perspective is quite distant, the character consistency might not be as pronounced as what we see in close-up shots. This is an example of the jointly trained Lora mode we discussed.
Now,
I've switched my high noise and low noise models to those that were trained separately. One named low and one named high. The prompt is the same, and all other parameters are identical. I've also fixed the seed. Let's run it again for a comparison to see what the differences are. Take a look. These are the differences between the two trained models. Of course, due to different numbers of epochs or other factors, you might find that the characters do not appear exactly the same. However, that is not the main point. What you should notice is that the jointly trained Lora yields higher contrast or clarity. Therefore, if possible, it is likely most suitable to jointly train a single model. Finally, let's discuss the installation of Musubi Tuner. If you choose not to use my provided image and prefer to install it yourself, that is also possible. The process is relatively straightforward. You can find the installation section on the Musubi Tuner GitHub page. It requires Python version 3.10 and Python Torch version 2.5, 1 or higher. Then, you simply need to install all the dependency packages. Therefore, the installation process is quite simple. Let's look at a practical installation demonstration. First, we use MVCC to check the CUDA version. Mine is 12.4. Then, let's check my PyTorch version. Currently, it's 2.6, which meets the requirements as it's above 2.5.1. Next, we will clone the repository, then navigate into the directory and install it directly. This typically does not encounter errors. The remaining steps involve downloading the models and ensuring stable network connectivity. This concludes our discussion today on Wan 2.2 model training. The content covered is quite extensive. The key takeaway is to determine whether you will employ separate training or joint training, and whether you intend to output two models or a single model. That's all for today. Follow me to become an AI expert.